Each year, major organizations within the marine industry descend on Washington, D.C. to meet with legislators, initiate conversation, and enact positive change for our industry. Whether it's tax reform, amendments to cargo class laws, or to change legislation from within the heart of the American democratic system. I went this year to document the collaboration of a small community as they came together to take on big challenges. I wanted to show the industry at large what these honorable organizations do in advocating for the advancement, protection, and dignity of a niche market. For 3 days, I followed Kitty McGowan and 12 delegates representing the US Superyacht Association as they walked the halls of Congress and spoke on the industry's behalf. This is what your support in these associations enables for the good of all who work in the marine space. This is the ABC.
The most important aspect of this whole Congress, which is why I'm so thankful that we have so many new people coming, is the fact that our industry is working together. So it's not just USSA here on the Hill talking about our own single individual issues. We're talking about working together in tandem with the International Yacht Brokers Association, working in tandem with the Marine Industries Association, with Rhode Island Marine Trade Association, and Massachusetts and Virginia. So wherever there's an issue, we're working together. And it's not just us, they're working with us as well. So last year when we had our issue with trying to get the US flag registry, one of the congressional leaders that was a little bit of an impediment to our challenge was Senator Jack Reed from Rhode Island. Now you think a little tiny state of Rhode Island, it wouldn't be such a big deal, but Senator Reed, there's only two senators from each state, so Senator Reed was a pretty loud voice, and he was not against our bill, but he didn't like the method in which we did it. We don't really have a strong ask, if you will, this year. Last year, and for the 10 years prior, we were here talking about trying to build the U.S., the large yacht flag registry, and that got done last year in 4 months. So this year, 10 years, yeah. An overnight success that took 10 years in the making, right? Yeah. And everybody else, how did you do it?
That was
exactly. Like, oh my, I was like, if we had to talk about this one more time. So this year, we're going back to talk about the success of that. So some of our meetings are to thank. We're doing a bit of a thank you tour with Congressman Smith, Congressman Bishop for the coastal state of Utah, as I mentioned on the call. But he was the guy who stuck his neck out there and said, hey, I think this is important. We're the only country, major country, that doesn't have a large flag registry. Why is that? It's crazy. So he's the one that helped get that done. So that is tomorrow at 5 o'clock, and we want everybody to be there. And once you're over in the house, you can find out if you go downstairs, it's really very cool. I encourage you to take some time in between your meetings, is to go down into the basement.
And we're back between two yetis in an underground lair beneath Jefferson Memorial with another founding father. See how I did that? That's cheap. And we're back between two yetis with Tom Damrich. How are you doing, sir?
Good. How are you?
It's wonderful to finally get you on the show.
Delighted.
It's been, I think I've been trying, chasing you down for about a year or two now. Since you announced your retirement.
Right, right.
And it's coming up now, isn't it?
Well, sometime between now and the end of the year.
Yeah? Oh, it's not fully determined yet.
Not fully determined. So it'll be about 3 months after my successor starts, so we don't have his start date or her start date, so.
Oh, so you don't even know who it is yet?
No, we don't know who it is yet.
But you're narrowing it down.
We're narrowing it down.
Good. Now, for those of you who don't know, Tom Damrich, you're head of what is the heart of the industry, really, aren't you? Everything starts with the boats. Everything starts with getting out, somebody buying a boat.
It all starts with somebody buying a boat, right. And the National Marine Manufacturers represents the manufacturers of boats, engines, and marine accessories. But we really, we work with everybody in the industry. Because
you do, because I was always surprised how you could join as a member of the MMA without being a boat manufacturer, but you're supporting the organization.
So our membership is basically open to anybody in the industry. And the reason is, you know, I've been with the MMA for almost 20 years, and it took me...
Did you start it?
No, okay. No. Actually, MMA's roots go back to 1904. When the New York Boat and Engine Manufacturers Association was created. And then there was a Boating Industry Association in Chicago. And we had two competing associations that both did shows. One did the New York Boat Show, one did IMTEC. They both had lobbying staffs. They both, you know, they competed. And in the mid-70s, the independent boat builders said, this is crazy. We need one association for the manufacturers. And so they forced the merger of these two to form NMMA in 1979, which was 40 years ago. You look at this industry, and it's boat manufacturers, it's boat dealers, it's marinas, it's distributors, it's, you know, big box stores like West Marine, it's the publications. There's so many aspects to the industry, and what the realization that came to me about 10 years ago is that we are an ecosystem. We're the boating industry ecosystem. And something that adversely impacts one part of that ecosystem is eventually going to adversely impact the whole ecosystem. And so we need to be working together. We need to have each other's back. If there's a problem that marinas are having, that's going to affect boat manufacturers and engine manufacturers and dealers and everybody else eventually. So we all need to help the marinas overcome this problem. And the same is true in every part of the industry. And so that's where we've been focused the past 10 years or more. And I think that's one of the reasons people are finally getting it. And that's, I think, one of the reasons we've seen the big growth in ABC this year.
Mm. It's that working together, the rising tide aspect.
Yeah, it is. I mean, our hashtag for ABC this year is Boating Means Business. Used to be we would come up here and talk with legislators and their staff, and you know, we were from the boating industry, and immediately they'd want to talk about their last fishing trip or about their last boating outing and, you know, how much fun boating was. And boating is fun, but boating is also big business.
Yeah.
And so we've turned our message to boating means business. Boating is jobs. Boating is lots of economic activity. Working with other outdoor recreation groups that we call the Outdoor Recreation Roundtable, we got the Congress to tell the Bureau of Economic Analysis to do a what's called an outdoor recreation satellite account to add up what is the value of outdoor recreation to our economy. And they came back and said that outdoor recreation is 2.2% of the U.S. economy. Now, that may or may not sound like a lot to you, but agriculture is 1%.
Wow.
Agriculture is 1%. Outdoor recreation is 2%. And recreational boating and fishing is over $38 billion of gross output of GDP. It's a big industry.
Yeah. That's amazing, actually. It's bigger than agriculture.
Outdoor recreation, all of outdoor recreation, is twice the size of agriculture.
But again, this is America. In England, outdoor recreation doesn't exist. We don't hunt, we hike, but we kind of ramble, we walk. We don't boat, we certainly don't fish.
Well, Americans love the outdoors.
America loves the outdoors.
Yeah.
That's why it's called the Great American Outdoors, right?
Yeah.
I can't wait to see what happens at ABC.
It's going to be a great week.
Yeah.
Great.
Tom, thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you. Yes, those are the things.
Don't worry.
Okay, first of all, you never shoot from behind.
I'm the lady.
Never
so
from the back corner panel.
I got you.
And always above the waist. There's a lot of guys here from Texas. It's a big contingency from Texas. There's a 10-day boat show in Texas. Isn't that stupid? Crazy.
Without some
effort,
you wouldn't be.
So think about the fact that in every state, because we are a republic, so in every state, a congressional district might have 50 different industries. So these legislators have to be up to speed on boating, fishing, commerce, on trade, on development, on a million different things. So part of our role here is really to educate them about the importance of the boating industry to jobs, economic impact, and to their individual districts.
Tell you.
And this would advise you, can't just connect.
It's really interesting. So I'm trying to keep everybody, you know, together so you're not, you know, switching a lot. Right now we're in the Rave Room building, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk downstairs and we're going to walk over so we can kind of give you the lay of the land, because now that we're in the building already, we're in the house office buildings, we can go downstairs. No, these are all here. Longworth. These are all here. Cannon.
It is very cool. There's a whole city. What you see on the top is just a little bit of it. Underneath, there's like tons of people.
So what's really interesting about the recreational boating industry is that we are a national industry, but we're connected very well through our marine trade associations, nationally and regionally. We did come together in 2018 to create a national workforce plan that can help our industry to grow and thrive now and in the future. The Strategy 10 plus 1 workforce plan was created in collaboration between, well, let me show you, all of these marine trade associations across the country.
Everything good in Texas?
Oh, you know how we do it.
What's happening here in Washington and how our associations are working together to make the difference? And they don't get it. So we thought, why not show them? Why not get all of us together and kind of show them how we do kind of make the sausage up here? So in addition to their job as a congressman or a congresswoman or a senator, they also are required to serve on committees. So they'll take a multitude of committees that fall into their political agendas, because some of the committees are more high visibility and are more high profile, and some are more for the what they're looking for. But this is the Committee on Education and the Workforce, which is a big deal right now and one of the things that we're talking about here on the Hill this year.
What's your thought of the day?
So far so good. We're getting through to a lot of people, we're getting in, meeting a lot of people, and it's been a productive morning.
Good. It's not even lunchtime.
Not even lunchtime. I've already met with my congressman and been into two other meetings already, so we're getting the message out. People know the boaters are in town.
So then they started kind of building up, then they go up the hill here, but we started down there and we're going up the way here.
We're headed to the next meeting, going to the Senate side now. So we've been in the House side of Representatives, and now we're headed over to see Senator Reed from Rhode Island and thank him for his support of our legislative bill last year for the U.S. Flag Registry. Very exciting.
And this is us breaking
the law.
Jaywalking.
So really what we're kind of trying to do is educate our industry about how the industry works together, not just in our own home ports, but across the country, and right here in Washington, D.C., on Capitol Hill, on educating different legislators and congressmen about what we do. And so you guys have a different spin on it. You're not really in our super yacht side, but if you can kind of let people know about what Seaport is doing, and some of your initiatives and some of the things that you have going.
Seaport is the little, we're different. We are the ones that will tow boats when they break down out on the water. And that is our connection with the super yacht. So if a yacht needs help going up and down a river, if they need help getting into a dock, getting transferred from marina to marina, they'll call our guys. And that's our piece of the puzzle. Recreational boaters in general, all around the nation, if they break down on the water, we're the ones that they call. Now, you'd think, well, Coast Guard does that. Coast Guard used to do that, but many, many years ago, 30 years ago, Congress told Coast Guard that they should really try to step away from non-emergency stuff and do more emergency things instead of the non-emergency things. And that developed our entire industry. So that's how we're, that's our piece of the puzzle.
So when the boat sinks, it's you guys.
Oh, we're all
it's
the same
us.
Group?
Exactly.
So maybe just quick introduction.
Sure, yeah. Maybe a long introduction.
With, Dick
here, yeah. Hi, Steve. I'm Dick Cromwell. I own Maritime Solutions and Green Boat Club in Rhode Island.
Great.
And I was there at the wonderful breakfast the other Sunday. It was really
oh, good,
fun,
good. So,
Phil LeBlanc, I own Safe Sea Towboat US, the recreational boat towing company in Rhode Island, and also chairman of Seaport, which is our association.
Great.
Hi, Kitty McGowan with Refit America, a division of the US Superyacht Association, and we worked very closely with your office last year with the US Flag Registry. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that. Kate Pearson, Safe Harbor Marinas. We have 80 facilities throughout the US and about 15 in Rhode Island.
I'm Andy Tisco, Bristol Marine. We have three facilities on the East Coast, and I'm glad to see you again here this year.
I'm Matt Rosenberg from East Greenwich. I'm with Colony Hardware. We supply different supplies to the boat yards in the state, and part of Refit America and the Superyacht Association, which we've got a great contingency up in New England.
I'm Dean West from the California Yacht Brokers Association. I have nothing to do with Rhode Island, but I am supportive of Refit America and the U.S. Superyacht Association members.
I am Mark Gadbois. I'm with Tradesman International. I have two offices in Rhode Island, about 200 offices nationwide, I just spent the weekend in Newport. So.
Oh, great. Well, how was it?
Saturday was beautiful. Sunday was rainy.
Yeah.
I live in Massachusetts, so it's only a 30-minute drive.
I'm Brian Dursey with the Rhode Island Marine Trades Association.
Great.
Steve Myers with Yachtco. We have, we're the online MLS of yachting, so we have 15 billion in yachts for sale and about 5 billion in towboat transactions a year. And I have a place at one commercial wharf in Newport. I stay every summer.
Great.
I'm Tina Cardone. I'm the executive director of Seaport. We are the National Trade Association for the Marine and Towing and Salvage Companies, of which Phil just said he's our chairman. Just to give you an idea of our volume, we do about 130,000 cases nationwide in support of the Coast Guard's mission of their towing acts on the water.
Great.
Herman, I work for Dennis and Yachts. We actually have a office in Newport. And we do a lot of work. In fact, we have some stuff coming up at the Newport Shipyard for the charter show, where Kitty and I have started an initiative this year for the first time where we're going to open a retail bag to try and get more commerce and show more, help the shipyard actually get more income and as well as get more revenue for the local people.
Great.
Keep thinking it's a state thing, but you guys are there.
Great. Well, let's actually head on into the Congressman's office.
Okay. For the American Boating Congress, which is the annual recreational boating fly-in. I'm out of Seattle. We have 735 member businesses, and Rosen Peck is a huge recreational angler. He's very familiar with our association. We like to say boating means business, and in Washington State, that's $7 billion of economic impact. So we. We're everything, like the Port of Olympia is a member, Port of Seattle is a member, marinas, boatyards, boat builders, insurers, that whole ecosystem is part of the recreational boating industry. And Troy is here from Roche Harbor Marina in the San Juans. And also I'm also representing, and we, the larger group here, is with Refit America, and we are looking to work and repair recreational vessels, larger recreational vessels. Okay. Those employ thousands of people, 20,000 people in Washington State make up their career based on recreational boating. So, and then also we are filming a documentary about how lobbying works, and we're thankful that you allow us to film it.
Of course.
So you'd be surprised at how much resistance we've gotten to it. Mostly because we want to be able to tell a positive story. We want to be able to educate our membership because we represent over 400 businesses across the country, mm-hmm. with a lot of them in your state, about the process and about how their voice matters and how Congress and industry really should work together to make things better. So we really appreciate this opportunity.
With Ian from Whidbey, obviously you see the economic driver with Nichols.
Yes.
Right there, a major shipbuilder right in that area.
Definitely.
So.
And I've actually been down to their shipyard area, so it's pretty impressive.
Well, he mentioned Refit America real quickly. I'll just say big boats equal big jobs. So we know that the the recreational boating industry does provide a lot of opportunities for high-paying skilled labor jobs, that which we know there's a shortage of right now.
Yes.
And we're worried on workforce development, but when they get into the boating industry, it is a good career path, and it's a high-paying career path.
We were actually in another meeting hearing about Pell Grants being able to be directed to trade schools, whereas previously, I guess, and I never qualified for Pell Grant, but for if I wanted to go to a university, I could get one, but if I wanted to go to a trade school, they weren't able to apply that to a trade school. So if that's something that you can mark down the support, you know.
Is that a current bill, or?
I believe that we have. But I mean, but to me, being able to have resources, now they're saying, maybe it's time to leave the building. But the importance of Pell Grants.
Yeah, that's one way to get rid of the group.
Yeah. Did you see him go to the little button right there?
Yeah, this is a real one. Okay.
This is all Katie's fault.
This has ever happened.
But damn, she's prepared.
And doggum it, on the first one we had approval to film. Darn it.
All the years I've been here, I've never been evacuated.
I thought the meeting went really well. It's pretty typical of how meetings go, where you're pitching them on your list of priorities, and it seemed like Jackson was super engaged. We'll see. It's all about the follow-up, though, and I need to follow up with him on some facts and figures and see where this goes.
And it's it is a case of just touch.
Oh, it's definitely, that's exactly right. It's all about drip. It makes it for a long process and a lengthy process, but if you show up day after day, you gain their respect, and you know that you show to them that you're here for the long haul. They want you to go away. They want you to come here today and not hear from you for another year. When you fly back for another big trip like this, but that is the worst kind of lobbying. So it's all about touch, and really figuring out what they like to hear about, see about, forwarding them articles about their list of priorities. That, hey, I was thinking about you, or I saw your legislator in the news. Here's an article that I saw, and you send, and you're at the top of their inbox.
Yeah. Hmm. Well, what do you do?
Sorry?
What do you do?
So I represent 735 businesses that are part of the recreational boating industry, from stand-up paddleboards to super yachts and everything in between. Those boats are built somewhere, and they have an association, and I am their mouthpiece on the government affairs side, so I advocate for them every day. Go to work and try to figure out a way that I can advance our legislative agenda. Most of the time, that doesn't mean coming to D.C., but if I need to come for a 15-minute meeting, I'll fly out here for a 15-minute meeting and fly back home. I did that in December, and my mom was wondering, like, what the heck is going on? Don't they have telephones? And I had explained to my mom that our best customer, mom, is as if you are selling a yacht to your best customer. You would fly to Dubai to sell it to them. And I had to come out here and meet with a key agency lead. Meeting went really well, and it was a pretty happy flight on the way home.
I love what he said.
You don't even have to put on heels for those.
Nope, I'm not putting on heels with these. These are done with the heels today.
Right, you haven't done your bit to camera.
That's right, you didn't, did you?
On the day I was born, the nurses all gathered around. They gazed in wide wonder at the joy they had found. Probably the one thing I would say would be that on the whole political aspect of everything is that so Viking Yacht Company was the first company I worked for, and they went from, and there was a 10% luxury tax that Congress put in place in the late 80s, it took Viking from like 1,400 employees to 40. And so they hired me as like employee number 41 right out of college. And what I noticed was that with, and I was selling boats overseas because they weren't selling new boats in the United States because people didn't want to pay the luxury tax. So with every boat I sold, every time I came back to the factory, I saw another 100 cars in the parking lot to build the boat. That doesn't count the crew and the salespeople and the maintenance people, and there's a whole economy around every yacht. So, you know, the big message that I always like to try to send to the politicians up here is, you know, it's not about, you know, focusing on the 1% whatever. It's about creating jobs, you know. And so with every yacht sold, every boat sold, there's a whole economy around it that goes back. You know, it's, talk about redistribution of wealth. It's the greatest redistribution of wealth. When you have a $1 million, or a $10 million, $100 million yacht, 10% of that value goes back into the economy, into jobs, et cetera, every year, minimum, plus all the other things that come involved around it. So that's kind of the main point I would put out there, you know, talking to the congressmen or senators or whatnot. It's all about jobs.
Well, thank you so much. I know you've had a crazy day, and just coming in from the airport, sit, relax, take a load off.
Two different things.
Well, I'm excited. We're going to be filming a little bit here, because what we're doing right now is filming, creating a little documentary about how things get done in Washington, and you are our, like our poster child for that. So I'm gonna reintroduce myself. We spent some time with you guys last year, Kitty McGowan with the US Superyacht Association. And for those of you that you haven't heard about, Congressman Bishop from the coastal state of Utah was our champion last year with getting the large yacht flag registry onto the NDAA in record-setting time, and making it all happen here, and at least from the House side, for sure.
But my name on the amendment, you guys made it happen. It's okay.
Yeah, but you stuck your neck out, and then
really,
we saw a lot of the back and forth, and you stuck your neck out for our industry, and we really, really appreciate it, and. We're working with, just want to kind of come back to you and say where we are now. We're a year later, meeting with the Coast Guard, moving it through. I mean, having a government shutdown for a couple of months this year did put us behind a little bit, but the Coast Guard is working on it, and we're plowing ahead, as they say. But
so they haven't finished that yet?
Not oh,
yet.
Heavens no.
they're making progress.
They're making progress. But we really appreciate all your efforts and wanted to come here and say thank you.
Bring this to you.
That's cool.
As a minor token of our appreciation.
Yes.
And since then, we've embarked on a new campaign called Refit America to promote building and repairing and cruising here in the United States, all under the U.S. flag registry, which will make it even easier to people to do that. So you were the start of a lot of great things, and I'll give all the paperwork to you so you have some background.
Cool.
And Devin, introduce yourself. So.
Yeah, Devin Weiser, I'm Chief of Staff to Congressman Bishop. Worked for him for about 8.5 years, been Chief of Staff for about 3 years. And last year we got to meet at about the same time.
Yes.
Same time last year. It was sort of a Hail Mary, but
it was.
It ended up working out, and we got it. We got her done.
But these guys, I mean, I tell you, that's the thing about that. What happens in Washington is that, I mean, we were on the phone at 2 a.m. because there was stuff pending, and these guys were on it from the start and didn't take their foot off the gas, and you guys were awesome. So we really appreciate it. That was it. We didn't want to take a lot of your time.
I just wanted to give this to you, yes. Yeah, and thank you again so much for being the champion of our industry. All of these people here in the room support the industry and got on the phone and called their local representatives, and people said, please make it stop.
See, that's how you get things done.
Yeah.
You just become you become obnoxious.
We really excelled at that.
We did really excel at that. So.
Look, this is obviously, you know, from Utah, which is so well known for its yachts. That can go in the Great Salt Lake. Now, this is one of those issues that when I'm confronted with it for the first time, it makes so much sense.
Yes. Right?
But people have self-imposed preconditions that they don't quite get it, they don't understand. It's like Austin Scott turned around and said, "Duh, this is a no-brainer. This is a way we get more revenue coming in if we do it the right way. Duh."
Yeah.
So it's one of those things that it simply required something to start it, a catalyst. Withdrawing the amendment at the right time proved prophetic, but that's when you guys kicked into gear and you made it actually happen. So I appreciate that, and the same thing, you had to go to bat over in the Senate. So you guys really made it happen. I'm just happy to be a small part of it, and a really small part. Devin helped out big time. Lee Lonsberry is my communications director here.
Thank you.
And we're all just grateful that we had a chance to be a part of this, because this was this was unique.
Oh shoot.
One, two, three. Again, one, two, three. One last one. One, two, three. All right.
Let's wave to the camera. Thank you, Congressman.
This is how we do it.
Thank you.
That's how it works. Thank you.
No,
you're a board member. Jim.
As balanced.
One board.
Actually, it is utterly fascinating. I have to say, I am probably the least likely. If you had asked me 10 years ago, would I be doing this, I would have said absolutely not. But there was a meeting with the US Superyacht Association where someone was talking about advocacy and coming to Washington and how you really do have these one-on-one meetings, and I was fascinated. So I thought, let me see what it's all about. And I love it. It's empowering. It's phenomenal. To really feel that you do have an impact.
Yeah, I was just saying that it was really interesting to see, and it was one of the most interesting pieces was to see the aides and the role that the aides play to the senators or the Congress folks is they're really the gatekeeper. So when we could see you know, how intrigued they were, and when they were taking notes and when they weren't taking notes, it allowed us to adjust what we were doing. So I thought it was really a worthwhile experience.
It's amazing the hands have killed them.
The next generation of leaders. So
we may have met the future president today.
Possibly. Yeah, possibly. And it was, again, it was the ones that kind of took it serious were really impressive to me. So. You know, I appreciate them taking time to meet with us because we're just boaters.
Less interesting.
So why are you here?
I'm here because of Kitty and her passion for our industry. Therefore, I decided to join her in her campaign to help grow the knowledge of our congresspeople and our senators here in Washington. Plus, I just wanted to have that experience because it's really cool. And I learned so much. I had no idea about ethanol and fuel and what that does to engines. I also learned that we are a deficit of trade workers in all aspects of the maritime industry, from manufacturing, yacht crew, electricians, plumbers, and how we just really need to launch a campaign to get more people interested in working in our industry because, which I hate to say this, we're getting a little older and we're aging out.
Well, the American Boating Congress is a phenomenal opportunity to interact with hundreds of industry individuals from all over the world. Come to Washington, D.C., work in concert with each other, and make some good things happen with our Congress. That's the way our Congress works. So I'm in the marine industry. I make a living from it. I am very involved in our industry associations and boards, US Superyacht Association, Marine Trade Association of Maryland, and others, and just love being involved in the industry and trying to make positive things happen. It's a very robust, very strong industry in the United States, and we need to continue to work towards making it an even stronger industry.
So this is probably the only time in the calendar year that we get 350 people, everybody comes to Washington, You have high-level execs from all over the boating industry, and we're talking about the issues that matter to their business, to their customers, and then we go up to Capitol Hill and we meet with decision makers and we tell them what are our problems, what are some of the opportunities, and it gives us really a chance to say that boating matters, and it's not just something that's fun and you do with your spare time, but there's actually a business behind it. And so we do that every year, and it's just not only a great opportunity to effectuate change, but it's an opportunity to network and to meet with your peers and to have a really nice time.
Yeah. So ABC really, it's only been, we had done a fly-in like this for years, but we branded it the American Boating Congress, I'm gonna say 10 or 15 years ago. And Nicole Vassilaris, who heads up our government relations office here in Chicago, put together some numbers. You know, 10 years ago during the Great Recession, we had 120 people here for this event, and we did 74 Hill visits. This year we've got 350 people registered. We'll have 280 Hill visits, and it makes a difference. I mean, it's grown every year, but this year we took a 40% increase in attendance this year. We had 250 last year, we got 350 this year.
Why is that?
So the word is starting to get out.
But yeah, why are you here at ABC?
So International Yacht Brokers Association has an agenda here in DC. We're attending the American Boating Congress, and the purpose of our visit here is to promote our deferred importation agenda. As many people know, foreign flag, foreign built vessels are not available for sale to U.S. residents while in U.S. waters. So what we're doing is proposing legislation. At the moment we have a resolution, a House resolution, or a bill sponsored by Representative Lois Frankel and Representative Ted Yoho, bipartisan support in the House, Bill number 2239, which asks for deferred importation. What it does is it shifts the time at which duty is collected on a vessel entering into the United States. Presently, if you want to offer your boat for sale in the United States, you either have the option of getting a boat show bond, which limits you to 15 days of saleability, or you have to exclude U.S. residents from viewing or purchasing the boat while it's in U.S. waters. Our goal is to have that time shifted to the time at which the boat sells, as opposed to having to collect the duty prior to offering it for sale. It's much like them asking you to pay the dock stamp tax on your house before you put the for sale sign in your front yard. We'd like to stop discriminating against U.S. buyers and offer these vessels for sale to U.S. residents while in U.S. waters.
I think what we've realized, and through the leadership of Tom Domerick, our president, is that we are so small in the grand scheme of things that if we don't work together, we're not going to get anything done. And so we have to put aside whether there are other differences. And really, I have to say, when it comes to the work we do here in D.C., we're all working together. We're hand in hand. And if we're going to be powerful and we're going to go up against some of our big competitors, because they're up on Capitol Hill today and they're talking about issues, whether it's ethanol industry that's talking about year-round sale of E15, or it's infrastructure week and everybody just thinks about roads and bridges, if we want them to care about dredging and waterways, we have to work together. And I think that people have seen that working together through ABC is really the only way to do it.
Why is ABC important to me? I think that one can't complain about things unless they participate. So I found it very important to participate in events like this, the ABC. I believe this is about my sixth time coming, and I find it very helpful. It's important to talk to our congressmen and our senators, and they do listen. They really do listen. You establish those relationships, and that way over the years, they know you, you know them, and you can call upon them, and things really do change. So I'm quite happy to be a part of it.
The bills that we have right now before Congress are trade bills, and we are looking for a vehicle right now that will be a bill package that would go to the floor for Congress for a vote, and ideally our bill would be added to that bill package. It's a little sort of special interest, even though it's all about minority jobs, because if you go to any boatyard in North America, you'll see that it's primarily made up of Latin American and African American workers there. And those are the people that make up a huge amount of the American workforce in the marine industry. And they're also well-paying American jobs. These workers on average earn 28% more than the same worker, a carpenter, plumber, electrician, working in the construction industry.
Very strong industry in the United States, and we need to continue to work towards making it an even stronger industry. So this is the place to make it happen. It's a phenomenal thing. Once people come to the ABC deal, usually people come back year after year. This is my fifth year, and I'll come every single year as long as I'm able to.
This is an NFA event.
We definitely helped to put it on, but it's turned into an industry event. We've done this for decades, and about 5 years ago, we came and we said, this needs to be the whole industry, the whole ecosystem. So whether you're a dealer or a marina operator, a large yacht broker, or a manufacturer, all these issues matter. And at the end of the day, elected officials don't care what part of the segment you're in, we're the boat people. And so we had 27 co-hosts from all aspects of the industry help us to put on that event. We had sponsors who helped us financially. So this is truly an industry event, and we're happy to help take the lead and be be there for organizing it, but everybody's involved.
I own a small manufacturing business, and every year I come to ABC, it gives me a chance to meet a lot of other people in the industry and to make our views known and educate our representatives on the Hill. It always amazes me how much they think they know about our industry and don't know, and how pleased they are to learn something. They're mostly very supportive, and it's a lot of fun and a lot of miles on your feet.
It is a lot of on your feet.
Especially when you get evacuated as we did yesterday from the Rayburn building.
So it's a chance for us to just make sure that our industry remains in the forefront of our lawmakers, our decision makers.
Which is what is the beautiful thing about America. You can go with no ID straight into the building and knock on the door.
That's very true. Absolutely. It's how our system works, how our government works. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing to witness, and it's a beautiful thing to experience, and I'm glad I'm a part of it every year.
It is a great way to learn about the industry broader than our piece of it, because we're all in it together, and we all have to support each other.
And is this your first year?
I think my eighth that I have come to this.
Wow.
In my family, it's sort of like everyone knows that in May, Vicky goes to ABC. So I really enjoy it. I'm a native Washingtonian. It's sort of in the blood to come and do these kind of things.
Great couple of days. Lots of fantastic meetings. Lots of great conversation. Some good movement on some bills in the House for the International Yacht Brokers Association. And a great opportunity to make new friends, new acquaintances, and to reestablish friendships with the people that have made it happen for us here in Washington. It's been a great couple days. We've had a fantastic group of USSA members working together. They came up here on their own time and own expense to work for all of us here in the industry. I'm eternally grateful. It's been a fantastic couple days. Thanks a bunch.
And so what would be your message to other people?
Get involved. It's your industry. Everything works together. Get to know your other members of the industry. And enjoy yourself. It's a great couple of days, and definitely worth the investment.
Okay, I want you to say into the microphone. Get involved.
Get involved.